Actually, I haven't registered, so I got to know about
this.
No, it's a private function, you can't come.
How are you?
Nice to meet you.
I am Cheryl.
Hi, I'm Cheryl. Thank you so much.
Yes.
This is my husband, Dan.
Okay.
Yeah, Vidhi.
Good evening and welcome to this important panel discussion on judicial appointments, which is being organized by the Vidhi Center for Legal Policy and the Campaign for Judicial Accountability and Reforms. A very warm welcome to our distinguished panelists and speakers. Thank you for taking time out despite the rain and your very busy schedules. Appointments to the higher and the subordinate judiciary have been much debated and discussed in this past year. But right from the S.P. Gupta versus the Union of India judgment in 1981, which accorded primacy to judicial appointments to the executive, to the Supreme Court Advocates on Record Association judgment 1993, which vested primacy in appointments with a collegium of judges, to the October 2015 Supreme Court judgment, which pronounced the constitutional amendment which introduced the National Judicial Appointments Commission and the National Judicial Appointments Commission Act as unconstitutional, and by a later order, the Supreme Court directed the government to draft a memorandum of procedure for appointments to the High Court and the Supreme Court. Since then, there have been various versions, opinions, consultations, and back and forths. And we're still debating. And as a campaign and at Vidhi, we don't want this to only be left to subject matter experts. Today, we hope to hear from many but strong voices on these various facets of judicial appointments, their importance, and the ways in which, while preserving the independence of the judiciary, the mechanism for these appointments will support transparency and accountability in the manner and functioning of the judiciary. To take the discussion forward this evening, I'd like to introduce our panel moderators. Our first panel for this evening, we've actually merged two panels. So our two moderators for this evening are Ms. Maja Daruwala and Alok Prasanna Kumar. Ms. Maja Daruwala is the Executive Director of the Commonwealth Human Rights Initiative with a keen interest in issues of accountability, particularly police reform and prison reforms and the right to information. She has worked on rights and social justice issues for around 3 decades. Welcome, Ms. Daruwala. Alok Prasanna Kumar is a senior resident fellow in Judicial Reforms Initiative at the Vidhi Center for Legal Policy and author on articles on constitutional law and judicial reforms. Alok is also the person responsible at Vidhi to put this whole thing together, this whole panel discussion. So thank you, Alok, and welcome. Before I hand over to Ms. Daruwala to take forward our discussion for today, I'd like to welcome Orgo Sengupta, Research Director at the Vidhi Center for Legal Policy, to give us a quick overview of the issues that will be discussed today.
Thanks very much, Cheryl, and good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Since we're already running late, I'm going to keep this very short and not stand between you and the panel, but with just two quick thoughts. The first is that we are, of course, in the middle of an almost crisis-like situation with the judiciary and the executive not agreeing on the memorandum of procedure as far as appointment of judges to the higher judiciary is concerned. This is not unprecedented, as in many here in the auditorium will know of the time when Chief Justice Kunchi was the Chief Justice, and there was a similar situation where judges were not appointed for a period because of disagreements about procedure. But this time what seems particularly problematic from a citizen's perspective is that in this power struggle, as in the citizen's voice and the need for reforms of the collegium, which was ultimately the primary reason as to why this memorandum of procedure process was engaged in, is lost. So we'd be really grateful as if during the course of this panel discussion we hear some key thoughts about the real reforms that the collegium system needs so that India gets the judges it deserves. And at the same time, as I think an oft-ignored issue, is the lower judiciary on the whole. The issues as far as the lower judiciary are concerned are distinct from the higher judiciary. There is, of course, a more transparent process that exists as far as the lower judiciary. But questions of diversity, equality, merit, and the integrity of several candidates who are appointed and the processes are still issues that require debating. And we have a great set of panels today. We've got a lot of people with very distinct as well as strong views. So we hope that at the end of the day today, we'll go away with some real understanding of things that need to be done to ensure that we get the reforms that we deserve and the judges that we deserve. With that, I'd like to hand over to Maja, the moderator for the first panel. Thanks very much.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I started off with worrying about too many people being on the panel, but given the rain and the number of events that take place in Delhi, we are lucky to have such a distinguished panel. Small, but very distinguished. Given that there are there were speakers here who have such lengthy and distinguished accolades that I could add, I could spend my time here on the stage just talking about each one of them, but I think most of them are so well known that I am merely going to introduce them by name. And for those of you who actually don't know any one of them, there's always Google. Okay? So, and that's for the ignorant. So, you will have them speaking for between 7 and 10 minutes, and I know that my duty is only to be really a timekeeper, and that is an unpopular thing, an unpopular duty, but as a courtesy to each other, I know that because there are two panels, our own panelists will be brief but very pithy, not be repetitive, and also please build off each other because there are so many nuances and so many problems that need to be addressed when we're talking about the appointments at the judiciary at both the higher and the lower level. This panel will particularly pay attention to the higher judiciary, but if there are important things to say about the lower judiciary, we must. There is so much wisdom to be had in my panel that I'm reminded of the words of Solomon, who said that if you have found the honey, in this case the wisdom, take not too much of it, lest you have a surfeit. So with my own, now to my own opening remarks. Not expected by now my alarmed organizers, but they will be also very, very short. Let's put the facts here, we have approximately 32 million cases pending. This is absolutely unconscionable. unconscionable for our country, unconscionable for development, unconscionable for democracy. It is just not acceptable. And if we start from that, maybe we will go and find some kind of remedy. We also have about 17,000, give or take, judges. The Chief Justice of India says we need 70,000. Some say less, some say more. But while we quibble over who appoints, how they are appointed, what is to be appointed, delay adds denial to an already a country that does not have any more the ability to give its people justice in a formal sense. Access to justice is denied. We cannot be called a litigious society, which is something that I often see in the papers and I do object to. When you think about it, who gets litigated, who goes to litigation? Those who have deep pockets, those who have influence, or those who have a hellish tenacity and desperation to actually go there and get their cases. Too often, they die before their causes are met. Now, we need judges, many, many more, and we need them quickly. We cannot compromise on quality. Already there is much questioning, though we keep it tamped down, about the quality of justice in the lower judiciary and elsewhere. We cannot keep on denying this. Judges have to be appointed. They have to be well paid, extremely well paid. They have to be well supervised and absolutely uncorruptible, incorruptible. Whoever makes the appointments, wherever the process comes to rest, whatever the procedure, we must assure ourselves for our own democracy, both quality and quantity. India cannot falter on the delivery of justice. We have too much at stake at this moment in time. There is so much simmering discontent, so much discontent coming, spilling out into the open, only to be tamped down rather than to get justice. With these remarks, just to set a context that you already know about, may I now invite Senior Advocate and former President of the Bar Council, Mr. Anil Divan, to make his remarks.
Thank you, Maya. But I was never president of the Bar Council.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I was president of the Bar Association of India,
yes,
which was one of the petitioners which attacked successfully the 99th Amendment and the NGAC Act. Now, today we are faced with a situation where there's a tussle between the Chief Justice of India on one side and his colleagues, and the executive, the political executive on the other. They are unable to agree upon a memorandum of procedure. Now, what is a memorandum of procedure? The memorandum of procedure is the procedure to be worked out for implementing the judgment of the Supreme Court. Now, after the last two judgments, we already had a memorandum of procedure, but something has now to be added in terms of the directions of the Supreme Court. And why is this tussle? This tussle is because the political executive is completely dissatisfied with the judgment. What it wanted to do was to control the judiciary and the judicial appointments where it has failed. And I think I will quote to you the words of a very senior member of the bar who was a law minister for a long time, Mr. H. R. Bharadwaj. And this is what he said: admitting that the political class has been always making attempts to control the judiciary, former Union Law Minister Bharadwaj dubbed the Supreme Court judgment in the National Judicial Appointments Commission case as landmark, as it protects the independence of the judiciary, ask his opinion. Through measures like NDAC, politicians try to control the judiciary. Bhardwaj said, is there any doubt about it? They have always been making attempts. So this memorandum of procedure and how to draft is another attempt trying to subvert and have larger impact and influence in the appointment stage. Now, what is the memorandum of procedure I have told you? What happened here? Here, the main judgment was delivered on 16th of October 2015, striking down both the Act and the Constitutional Amendment. That was the first step. Then there is a consequence hearing because there were flaws, shortcomings in the collegium system which was at that time prevalent and which are now being restored. So the Supreme Court in its directions on 16th of December 2015 laid down four criteria. One is we should have eligibility criteria, number one. Then we should have some transparency. Then we should have something on the secretariat. And the fourth thing was something if there is a complaint against a potential judge. So they divided it in four heads. Now, my first point is, why is the judiciary and the executive not sharing with the public the drafts which have been exchanged? Why not? Why are they being kept secret? And I blame both sides, both the judiciary and the executive, of not sharing the drafts which are being exchanged, so that we are only speculating what is happening. There are leaks, informed leaks, saying that government wants national interest as a criterion and they can refuse if a candidate is not able to fulfill the test of being in the national interest. Now this is too vague. That's one. The second thing is about merit. The third thing is about seniority. Now why is this, and why is not the judiciary taking the bar and the public into confidence? Why don't they release it tomorrow so that we can comment? This I am failing to understand. That's my point number one. Point number two, if the Supreme Court itself on 16th of December order said that we ourselves were anxious to frame a memorandum of procedure. Now what's happening? All appointments have got stalled. The government is not going forward with it, not processing it at all. If that be so, why is it that the Supreme Court cancelled this order or recalled this earlier order and said we'll do it ourselves and do it rapidly? And then there's an end of the chapter because it's a judicial order which has to be obeyed. I think that is the way to solve the problem in case the government does not want to go forward with something which is acceptable. Now with this, two things remain. I'm only going to comment on transparency. And what we had suggested was that the basic appointments are made in the High Court. So if you want transparency, and if you want to know who are the potential candidates, let's have a list, maybe a short list, of those who can apply and those who have applied, including their applications, their experience, their income, their standing, their seniority, etc., whatever they want to say. If they have been academics, they have been academics. And it was suggested at the bar that one of the things which they should mention is, are they related to sitting or retired judges? Because there's a big complaint that sitting and retired judges do influence potential appointments all over the country. So why not disclose it? Because if he's selected later on, that will be a point which the public will know. So that's on transparency. We had suggested a complete list, a complete database which is in the public domain so that we can know who has been selected. Now one of the shortcomings and one of the complaints was that one senior judge was able to manage appointing his sister as a High Court judge. This is well known amongst the members of the bar. And if at that time people knew who were the other potential candidates, they could have said that this appointment is clearly wrong. Public opinion would have rallied around other candidates, etc. So this is transparency in persons who are going to appoint or potential candidates is one important thing. The second point I want to make is about the secretariat. The secretariat, like the Supreme Court registry and the High Court registry, has to be completely in control, both as to the appointments to the secretariat as well as the functioning of the secretariat. Why does today the registry of the Supreme Court, they don't care anything about the law minister or any department, etc. They go by what the judges say, the chief justice or the designated administrative judge. What the government wants is a secretariat which is part of the Department of Law and Justice. I think this is the most insidious attempt to influence. Once a secretariat within government control comes, there is no confidentiality. Every potential candidate, pluses and minuses, pros and cons, will be known to the members of the political executive. This will be the worst thing which can happen. The secretariat has to be completely under the control of the judiciary and the collegium, whatever it is. So having made these 2 points, friends, I leave the stage for the other speaker. Thank you, Maja.
Thank you so much, Anilji. May I call on Mr. Shanti Bhushan, and Anil, I have special thanks for keeping within the time and being so cogent about your points. Mr. Shanti Bhushan, sir, is a former law minister and is too renowned for my lame introductions.
Friends, we are discussing a topic which is very important for the whole country, because judiciary plays a very important part in the lives of all people in the country. Therefore, the country needs that the judiciary at every level must be manned by the best possible people in the country. But how to do it? Of course, there was a time when there were no problems with the system which was going on. The Chief Justice of the High Court used to send recommendations. Thereafter, the government of the state also made recommendations. And finally, the Supreme Court Chief Justice made its decisions. And finally, the law minister in the country and the prime minister decided the matter. At that time, in those early years, there was no conflict because the politicians of those days were not trying to push their own people into the judiciary. They knew the importance of having an independent judiciary. And the judiciary in those days was very, very, very independent. Even during the period that I was law minister, I can tell you frankly, there was no attempt ever on my part to influence either the Chief Justice of any High Court or the Chief Justice of India to suggest. I never even suggested any name. And when on a name, there was unanimity between the Chief Justice of the High Court and the Chief Justice of India, I treated it as complete, final. Namely, there would be no interference from the executive at all. The only part of the executive, in my view, in those days was, if it had some information about any person whose name was being considered, to draw the attention of the Chief Justice of India to those facts and let them take that into consideration in order to finally make up his mind. But today things have changed. We are not in 1950s or 60s or even 70s. we are in the 21st century, where the politicians are so keen, they are less concerned about the country and more concerned with their party and themselves. So in this changed situation, I entirely agree that no important role can be left to the government, because the government consists of politicians. It is impossible to really expect politicians of the kind which we had in 50s and 60s and so on. Therefore, ultimately, it is the judiciary which will have to shoulder the main responsibility of making appointments. But as all of you are aware, even those judges who were responsible for creating the collegium system, one of the very distinguished Chief Justices, J.S. Verma, who is unfortunately no more, he had gone public to criticize the collegium system, because the way the collegium system was being operated was, if there were three vacancies to be filled, the collegium will get together, the favorite of one, favorite of another, favorite of a third, and they would divide the appointments among themselves in many cases. Now, today that might not be the position. Many things have happened today. There have been direct appointments on the bar to the Supreme Court. Very distinguished people have been persuaded to accept judgeships in the Supreme Court. I mentioned two of them, Rohinton Nariman and Nageshwar Rao. Now they were having very extensive practice at the law, very lucrative practice, but they were persuaded. They had earned a lot of money. They did not need any more money. Their integrity could not be doubted by any person. They were had to be persuaded to accept seats on the bench. And we are grateful to them that they accepted that request and accepted, and they are doing very distinguished work in the Supreme Court. I feel more and more members of the distinguished bar of the Supreme Court need to be persuaded to accept seats on the Supreme Court bench. But yet, when that is said, the bulk of the people in the Supreme Court bench will have to come from the high courts. And therefore, ultimately the question is how to guess the best judges. Now, we have invented so many things which are not the constraints created by the Constitution, but we have created them. First, age. They say, unless you become 44, 45, you should not be appointed as a High Court judge. In the Supreme Court also, they consider, unless you have become 55 or 56, you should not be considered for appointment to the Supreme Court. Now, I tell you, two cases. One of Justice Shah Suleiman, who was appointed as High Court judge in Allahabad High Court when he was only 34 years old. And he went to the Federal Court, and he was such a distinguished judge because an able lawyer who has extensive practice does not wait till he becomes 40 or above to distinguish and to get it known how distinguished he is. What are the qualities which are necessary in a judge to perform well? In my opinion, of course, it goes without saying that the integrity should be absolutely doubtless. There should be no hint of any chance of corruptibility on the part of any person. What is the position today? I don't have personal experience of the Delhi subordinate judiciary, but very recently, a person who has been the president of the District Bar Association told me in no uncertain terms that not less than 80% of the subordinate judges in Delhi are prepared to take money in particular cases. What is this? What kind of justice will be administered by these people? They may not be taking bribes in every case, but if they are prepared to take a bribe in a case where they can get a handsome amount, that is, I can't conceive of their being a judge. When I started practice in 48, it was impossible to even imagine that a high court judge could be corrupt. Impossible to imagine. And at that time, the federal court had taken a very strong view. There was a complaint against the judge of the Allahabad High Court. And the complaint was not that he had taken a bribe. He had tried to favor an advocate so that that advocate's practice may go up. And this was considered so serious that the entire federal court, consisting of five judges, said that he has to be removed. And under the Government of India Act, he was removed. And this was the situation at that time. Namely, this kind of a favoritism to a lawyer was treated such a grievous offense on the part of a high court judge that he had to be removed. Today, if you ask any knowledgeable member of the bar, he will tell you probably there is not a single high court in the country, as far as I know, in which corrupt judges don't exist. What is their percentage? Well, it is very difficult to say, but the percentage cannot be very low, in my opinion. Therefore, we will have to devise a method by which total integrity of a person who is appointed as judge can be ensured. That is point number one. Number two, in my experience, one judge who is exceptionally intelligent disposes of fairly at least five times the number of cases which a ordinary judge can dispose of fairly. Because once a person is very highly intelligent, he takes more time understanding things. We have to hunt out these people, try to catch them at young. There was one Justice Mahmood in the last century. He had come from the subordinate courts to the High Court. And how did he come? One of his judgments, which had been reversed by the High Court, went to the Privy Council. And when the Privy Council saw the judgment of the subordinate judge, they said, what is this man, brilliant man, doing in the subordinate judiciary? He should be immediately appointed to the High Court. And on their recommendation, he was immediately appointed to the High Court. At what age? You will not believe it. He was only 32. No question of seniority. Today, they say, no. Unless a senior person is considered unfit, he cannot be superseded. There may be a brilliant person waiting below 10 people, but that brilliant person will not be taken. Mediocres will be taken because they are seniors and nobody can say they are totally unfit. That is the criterion which is being applied. What we need today is there should be a mechanism in which the best brains in the country can be hunted out. And of course, assuring that their ethics are so strong that they will be totally incorruptible. Neither the members of the Supreme Court Collegium or the High Court Collegium or even the government law minister, they don't have any time. They are busy with their work. All the judges of the Supreme Court every day have to work from morning till evening. They have to dictate judgments even on Saturdays and Sundays. Where do they have the time to find out in the country where are those bright, distinguished people available? So that is why, particularly, I have been saying for a long time that there has to be a whole-time secretariat whose job will be to go and find out everywhere in all parts of the country where those bright and brilliant people are and who are incorruptible, whose morals are so strong that they cannot be corrupted, and keep and prepare a list of all those people from which the appointments could be made, final appointments could be made by any collegium, etc. But information of every kind about every possible person who could be considered must be available. And why should it not be made public? India is a republic where the sovereignty resides with the people. Every institution is appointed by the people on their behalf by following a particular system. They are the delegates of the people. So the delegates, the managers who are appointed by the people, why should they keep things hidden from the people themselves who are sovereign in this country? In America, a judge who has to be appointed to the Supreme Court, not only his name would be made public long before appointment, but a Senate committee will grill him for several hours to find out everything about him, and the people would know what kind of a person is being appointed to the Supreme Court of America. I won't go to that extent in India. Conditions here are different. But why should the people not know, particularly before appointment? The name who is proposed to be appointed must be made public, so that if anybody has any adverse information against that person, then he can send it to the appointing authorities to be taken into consideration. Therefore, because many times there are many facts which are not known to the people who consider the appointment of those persons. But it is only some people in the country might know something about him, which makes him totally unfit to be appointed as a judge. Therefore, why should the people not know and get an opportunity to send whatever adverse information they have in their possession with any material that they have to support that information? Therefore, the secretariat, of course, it is quite premature today to discuss the composition of the secretariat, but still, I would venture to put out a thought. Firstly, the secretariat must be headed by at least 10 people who are knowledgeable about the judicial process and who are prepared to say that they will never accept any check. Now, how to select these 10 persons? I am throwing an idea. At the time of the Lok Sabha elections, why can't we have a system that these 10 persons, lawyers, retired judges, etc., who are willing to man this secretariat, will be elected by the people at the time of the Lok Sabha elections? That's an idea which may never be accepted by anybody, but that's my belief that that will be the best way that the people's aspirations would be covered, and we will have 10 people who will go with other subordinate staff, go around the whole country and keep a big list of names of totally incorruptible, very intelligent, competent people to man the judiciary of this great country. So far as this conflict is concerned between the government and the Supreme Court, well, as Mr. Divan said, the ball is in the Supreme Court's hands. Supreme Court knows what is best, but since they are also aware of the criticism which the collegium system has attracted, particularly that lack of transparency, etc., they will have to devise ways. They will have to devise ways as to how transparently the collegium system can work. I particularly see no harm if along with five senior judges of the Supreme Court, even if you introduce a law minister, what can the law minister do? Law minister won't be able to influence the views of five senior judges of the Supreme Court, including the Chief Justice of India. So there should be, I don't think the independence of the judiciary will be affected. After all, in so many things, they have to meet and discuss various things and so on. But that's an idea which is for the Supreme Court to consider. But I feel that this country deserves a judiciary which is excellent in every way. It is possible to provide it, but we will have to think on new time. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Shanti Bhushan, for that. You and Anil Bhai touched on the crux of the whole, the crux of the dilemma is that depending when we, what are the disposal of his cases, etc., but the question of integrity really depends a lot also not merely on reputation, but also on the internal culture of the judiciary. How acceptable has corruption, how acceptable has taking money under the table or being biased against one or the other litigant in front of you, whether he's a Dalit, whether she's a woman, how these biases play out in your judgment, how do you measure those things? Those are really important things to be thinking about. May I, before I introduce my next speaker, welcome Mr. Nilotpal Basu, who is also going to speak at the end of this thing. So, welcome. And may I now introduce Mr. Manoj Mitta, who is a very senior journalist who has worked with many newspapers and is presently always been focused throughout on law and human rights and has written extensively on judicial accountability and has authored two books, one of which I had the honor of releasing in Amritsar. Chandigarh. It was Chandigarh. Well, it was very far away anyway. So, Manoj, please.
Thanks, Maya, and I'll try and stick to your advice of building on what the previous speakers already addressed. There was a great deal of discussion about the importance of transparency, and that's a factor that could not be overemphasized. I'd like to begin by pointing out that we are meeting today against the backdrop of three conflicts. Two of them very directly between the judiciary and the executive. One is, of course, on the issue of the vexed issue of ME, that memorandum of procedure. And the second issue, a related issue, being this freeze on appointments. And on this aspect, apparently the conflict is between the judiciary and the executive, the public at large can feel its impact already. Several high courts across the country are working way below their capacity, and that's adding to the problem of pending cases, which Maya referred to earlier. Now, the third conflict, which has not been touched upon by anybody, relates to the question of RTI, whether judiciary, whether specifically the question of appointments to the judiciary should come under the ambit of RTI or not. And not very long ago, on August 17th, three-judge bench of the Supreme Court referred this long pending issue to a constitution bench, a five-judge bench. Now, this is an aspect on which the citizens at large have a direct stake. And the specific issue involved in that case was a set of appointments that were made by the collegium, I think in 2009 or 10, and the RTI applicant was interested in knowing why a certain judge, namely Justice A.P. Shah of the Delhi High Court, was not considered for appointment to the Supreme Court, why he was overlooked. What is it that made the Supreme Court supersede him? Now, related to that quick case was the fact that when he was Chief Justice of the Delhi High Court, Justice Shah had delivered a judgment on another RTI matter. This related to the disclosure of assets by judges, whether they should be forced to make their assets public under RTI or otherwise. And he had, in the eyes of the Supreme Court, in the eyes of the judicial establishment, had the audacity to say that yes, judiciary also comes under RTI, and there is nothing wrong in judges being made to disclose their assets. Now, when he was subsequently superseded, this question actually arose in the minds of the public whether he was being punished by the judiciary for this reason. But the way the judiciary, the way the Supreme Court frames it was, one of the questions, I'll mention a couple of questions which have been reported in the media, of what the three judge bench. Before that, it was a two judge bench. This matter, incidentally, has been pending for the last 6 years or so. And it's now, in the year 2016, they are referring it finally to the constitutional bench. First, it was before a two judge bench, it sat on it for a few years, then it referred it to a three judge bench. Now, the three judge bench finally, in its wisdom, says, okay, a five judge bench needs to look at it. So it all remained within them. No decision came out. So the public are still have been just kept waiting. Now, what is it? What is the question? What are the questions they are addressing? Whether the concept of independence of judiciary required and demanded the publication of the prohibition of furnishing of information sought. The information that was sought was what were the reasons for somebody like Justice A.P. Shah, who was so widely respected, being overlooked. Now the Supreme Court wants to know whether any information related to the reasons for his being overlooked would compromise the independence of judiciary. And the other question is whether the information sought for amounted to interference in the functioning of the judiciary. Now, their approach, their anxiety to keep all the information to themselves is clearly not something that is in the interest of the public, nor is it really serving the independence of judiciary, because we have seen that even while they keep all the powers to themselves, when they have the primacy under the 93 Act, under the 93 judgment, this is the opaque manner in which they have been making appointments. And a contrast to Justice A.P. Shah would be somebody like Justice P.D. Dinakaran. Now, here is a man who was facing a whole lot of allegations. Sometime back, Mr. Shanti Bhushan was talking about how in the good old days, when there was an allegation that a judge probably favored a lawyer in the course of his functioning, and he was acted against. Now, the allegations against this man were not anything so subtle. They were really gross. There was a string of properties that were established to have been bought by him while he was in office. And there was a whole lot of evidence of his having misused his office, his judicial powers, to procure such assets. All this was so rigorously documented, and yet the then collegium was very squeamish about letting go of this recommendation that they had made. It became a prestige issue for them. And when more and more evidence was piling up and coming out in the open, they held on to it. Now, as a citizen, as a consumer of justice, as somebody who's refusing to be, enamored of their claims of being above all these mundane matters, I wanted to know at that stage as a journalist, what is it that is making the collegium hold on to this particular appointment? It's another matter that finally, because of the threat of impeachment proceedings and so on, they had to let go of it. It was a humiliating setback to the collegium, and it showed once more how, despite all their claims to being acting in public interest, their functioning can be so whimsical and so contrary to public interest. So, I guess I've run out of my time. So.
2 minutes.
Okay. So, this. So I would think that more than this question of primacy of who should have the last word, like one has been reading reports, some very good reporting has been done by Indian Express, by my friend Manish Chibber, on what has been going on between the executive and the judiciary, one of the three conflicts I was referring to, that is on the MOP. Now, again and again, this question that was apparently playing on the minds of the two institutions is, who will have the last word? Who will have primacy? Now, will this MOP be a backdoor way of the executive having a veto power and sort of overruling in effect the primacy regained by the Supreme Court through its judgment on the National Judicial Appointments Commission. Now, from the point of view of citizens, beyond the point, this question of primacy is not as important as this issue of transparency, because we know that even when the judiciary has had primacy in the matter of appointments, we have had these kind of appointments being made, and somebody like a while ago, Mr. Anil Divan was talking about some very good appointments being made from the bar. One Mr. Nageshwar Rao being the latest example of that. Now, he came in place of a man whose appointment was spiked by the executive, and that was Gopal Subramanian. And one clear reason, an unstated reason, was his role in bringing the BJP President Amit Shah into trouble for the role he played in the case relating to Sohrabuddin. It was at the Supreme Court's instance that he gave an advice which resulted in the case being booked against him. Now, was he being punished for that reason? Was he being dropped for that reason? Now, there was a need for transparency in that matter, whether it is from the executive or the judiciary. Now, these are all very disquieting questions which played on the minds of citizens at large when this controversy was being played out. But each institution was being very opaque. Just as Mr. Anil Divan said a while ago, these drafts of MOP also are being exchanged between themselves. Neither side wants to be transparent. So what is more important than primacy? Because we have seen that even in the days, in the pre-93 days when the executive had primacy, there were some very bad appointments made, and in the post-93 scenario also, some very questionable appointments have been made, and some very good independent judges have been overlooked. So it is not so much primacy from the point of view of consumers of justice. It is not so much the which institution should have primacy that is important, as much as this need for transparency being observed and displayed at every stage. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Manu. you know, whimsical is such a polite word. I love it. Some other words come to my mind. I'm not saying anything because we're talking about the judiciary here. Motivation, hushing up, dirty linen. Those are some words that come to my mind. But also, and in the case of people like Gopal Subramaniam and A.P. Shah and what we know about them in the public domain, there's a nice American saying that if it looks like a duck, if it waddles like a duck, if it quacks like a duck, then it is a duck. You don't have to look much further. So, may I introduce now Dr. Mohan Gopal, who is the former director of the National Judicial Academy and knows a great deal about the quality of judges and what you have to teach them and how much they do absorb, and a former director of the National Law School of India, sir. And I think you must be the first person I'm introducing without making a mistake.
Thank you, Ms. Daruwala. It's a pleasure and a privilege to be here. I think what brings us together is clearly two things. One is the striking down of the NJAC, NJAC by the Supreme Court, and second, the impasse in appointment of judges that has ensued as a result of the judgment requiring a memorandum of procedure to be set up and asking the government to initiate that procedure, and therefore the lack of consensus. My own careful reading of the judgment actually leads me to the conclusion that the NJAC judgment does not reflect a genuine disagreement between the executive and the judiciary on what I believe is the most fundamental issue facing the country on judicial appointments. Rather, the NJAC judgment reflects, I think, a well-founded lack of confidence in the judiciary, in the commitment of the political executive, not just this regime, but also the previous regime, to the principle of independence of the judiciary. And it's not A, B, C, or as individuals, but as a class. I think the judiciary feels that the political leadership of this country at this point of time is not committed to the idea of judicial independence. And so there is a reluctance, I think, to hand over significant power to the political executive in the appointment of judges, because however bad the collegium system is, I think very few people will disagree that it was an improvement and on what came before it, before the situation that Chief Justice Wagma intervened to correct, improve the situation from where it was. That doesn't mean the collegium system was the answer or the solution. So I think we must recognize that we are dealing with a situation where handing over power to the political executive is seen by many people as actually dangerous to the independence of the executive. Now, why is it dangerous? And I would say it is dangerous because there is a lack of consensus amongst all of us in this society over two visions of India, one liberal and one illiberal. One socially just, one socially unjust. The big challenge facing this country is, as we go forward, who will dominate this country when it is now democratic and independent? Will it be the same Hindu upper caste elites that have dominated this country for the last many years? Or will there be a new, a change of power and a transition of power in the favor of common people and poor people in this country who will acquire power? So these two visions, a liberal vision of a free democratic society with freedom of speech and dissent, with no hierarchy, no privilege, accountability, transparency on one hand, and on the other hand, an attempt to repair and maintain the old traditional unequal hierarchical social system. There is no consensus about this. And on this, I think what we've seen is, except for a brief window of 14 years between 1973 or 1987, when one or all of the so-called gang of four, Justice Krishna Iyer, Justice Bhagwati, Justice D.A. Desai, and Justice Chinnappa Reddy in that order, were on the Supreme Court bench. And we had a glimpse of the potential and possibility of a Supreme Court that would take us towards a pro-poor, a democratic, a just social order. And actually wrote a judgment in S.P. Gupta and Union of India saying that the Supreme Court is an instrument of social revolution, not social reform, of social revolution. The only vision in the world, in the whole world, of judges as revolutionaries. That is the kind of vision that came out of those four judges mainly in those 14 years. I think we've seen a serious reversal of that kind of vision of the judiciary after that period, and especially post-Mandal Commission, when the ruling elites of this country felt a great threat, especially the Hindu upper caste felt a great threat from a rising social underclass. And there has been a closing of the ranks, whether it's judicial, executive or political, to prevent that kind of social change. So when Justice Chandru of the Madras High Court retired, a very, very progressive a judge, very popular judge, there was a letter to the editor in Chennai which someone sent to me saying, India does not need more judges, India needs more Chandrus. Because Justice Chandru was a judge of the poor in the tradition of Justice Krishna Iyer who mentored him. So can we think of an appointment process that will bring to the judiciary people from economically deprived backgrounds, people from OBC, SC, ST backgrounds, women, minorities? We've had, I think, if my count is right, it can't be very wrong, I think there have only been three Dalit judges in the entire history of our judiciary, and there is now no Dalit judge. We've had maybe three or four women judges, and now there's one. The typical Indian judge is Hindu, upper class male. And, we need an appointment, so the quibbling over the memorandum of procedure is not going to solve this. We need an appointment process that will address this fundamental need to change the social character of the judiciary, to democratize the judiciary, and get from the judiciary a vision and a jurisprudence that is in line with the revolutionary social goals of the Constitution. And therefore, I think we have to ask ourselves, what would that system be? How can we get there? We have many examples in this country. I very much like Mr. Bhushan's suggestion of a very, very democratic suggestion of electing, a set of people who will be the selectors of the judiciary. That's something worth thinking about. It's a new idea. I've not thought about it, but I think it's in the right direction. We know that 87% of the judges in the United States are elected in general elections. Now, that's also a controversial system. All decisions on fact and the application of law to facts to determine guilt or innocence are made by juries, by common people. We need to democratize our judicial system and see the appointment process as an inherent part of that process of democratizing our judicial system, which is very essential to democratize our judiciary. So that the judiciary will become once again a positive role in democratizing our society rather than blocking it. Meanwhile, I think when the political executive is also not any longer engaged in the process of social change or social reform across the spectrum, and for the first time in this country we have a political executive that draws its inspiration from an ideology which on its website says that ideology is to establish a political order that will require the overthrow of the constitution and the establishment of a Hindu Rashtra, and openly says that monarchy is better than democracy, that equality is a bad idea, that independence is a bad idea. This is the stated ideology on the website. And therefore, when we have such an executive,
in power, and I'm saying that others may not be so explicit about their vision, but I don't think there's much difference between any of these political parties in terms of their lack of commitment to a democratic change in the society. I think there is need for caution in moving forward. Neither the NJAC nor the collegiate system is adequate to fulfill the vision of the constitution, and I think common people, all of us, should come together and come up with new ideas on how we can have an appointment process that will help build a judiciary that will take us forward to a more egalitarian social order. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Mohan Gopal. I'm not going to add my own comments because you have managed to depress me thoroughly. I'm just going to hush. I do want that there should be some time for Q&A before the next panel. And I should have said that earlier, I'm sorry. And now I'm left to introduce Dr. Nilotpal Basu. Mr. Nilotpal Basu, or in this case, Comrade Nilotpal Basu, who is a member of the CPIM Central Committee and a former MP. And sir, because you are the last speaker, it's a bit unfair, but if you could keep it short and perhaps make it very provocative so that there can be questions and answers. 7 minutes? Thank you.
Thank you very much. At the very outset, I will start with two caveats. One is that unlike the previous speakers, I have no first-hand experience about the judicial process. And number two, that I don't think we should treat the issue as a subjective one, attributing positives or negatives to individuals. Because I think the laments of Shanti Bhushan ji about the olden times and now, it is really unrelated to quality of individuals. And I am also provoked by my previous speaker because he was referring to this whole Vandal Commission issue. There was a very interesting coincidence that 1991 was the period where India aligned itself very thoroughly with the global reform process, and which actually took this position that increasingly elected representatives of the people and their role in governance as such has to be kept out. I mean, quote-unquote experts, and invariably they were from the World Bank, from the International Monetary Fund. They will be in the decision-making process in a more preeminent manner. And I think it is foolhardy on our part to presume that what changes we are seeing within the judiciary is also unrelated to the process that is affecting the globe, that is affecting our own economic, social and political processes. So I think one can claim that a judiciary is the last Mohican which will defend all those old constitutional values and all that. Some of the judgments that we are seeing in recent times does not inspire that kind of confidence. I can refer briefly to the case about panchayat elections in Haryana and Rajasthan, where ultimately it was the Supreme Court which decided, and which was a shame and a blot on our constitutional spirit that people, 70% of the voters were kept out from contesting the elections because they did not have the requisite educational qualification, they could not build public toilets in their own homes and so on and so forth. So I think let us not talk about that. In fact, if you see Supreme Court judgments, increasingly post 1991, they have been in alignment with the policy regime that came into force in the country. Therefore, I think the question of independence today should not be confused with insularity. Independence is something in which I think any liberal, as he was saying, will have any true opinion about. It has to be there. But at the same time, increasingly, the collegium system also has started arguments which is replacing the spirit of independence with that of insularity. So I think transparency is the watchword which is becoming much more important. And I don't understand that if introduction of representatives from either the executive or the legislature, how does it make the judiciary less independent? The question is that procedure should be followed. As Mahmoud, I am a great fan of his writings, has exposed many of the things which normally we are not following that closely. But the question is that unless we have transparency, same problem is there with executive. Same problem is there with legislature, because I can talk about legislature or executive with a little more authority because I have been part of that process. That without transparency, you cannot have credibility. So for credibility, for making the system credible, you need transparency. And I think it is by becoming more inclusive in the decision-making process, in judicial appointments, that you invest yourself with that degree of credibility and elements or potential elements for transparency where you could make a much bigger. And the other problem, I think we cannot shut our eyes to, I am thankful to my president, the previous speaker. You see, it is not just that. I find a very eerie convergence between the basic supporters of Hindutva Brigade and the composition of the judiciary. I would hope that that is merely accidental, but the fact remains that it is as such. And therefore, you see, mob justice has come to influence judicial pronouncements. And the latest that death sentence that was served, some of us who were opposing that, not from any other ideological consideration, but from basic judicial principles and on based on the evidence. We are sorry to say that there is a clear impression that the mob which was agitating outside had influenced, and the kind of decisions that had taken place on issues that are related to communal violence and all that really does not inspire that kind of confidence. So I think all of us, the society, the people at large, we are in difficulty. Yes, there is a conflict going on between the liberal and the illiberal forces. Therefore, if we presume that the judiciary or the process of corruption that is taking place, because it is systemic, it is no longer due to individual moral digression or degeneration, it is built into the process. Therefore, one of the biggest mistakes would be to presume that the judiciary is insulated from this and strengthen the insularity that the Supreme Court collegium system is already practicing, further that by in the name of independence. Therefore, I think the solution lies in making it more inclusive, but at the same time, come up with transparent parameters and also transparency and public disclosure and public participation in the process of the judicial decision making process. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Now we have a little time. I leave it to the organizers to tell me how much time. But I think that people have been very patient, so perhaps we should ask, take a few questions. I see 15 minutes. Did you want to make an intervention, Mr. Day?
I just started and speaking. I think the nature of this meeting to come out and discuss a question that has only been going back and forth between the Supreme Court and the executive, I think that's one of the most important things to do and acknowledge. And to have not just the kind of people sitting in this room, many of them to do with the legal profession, but to understand that the judiciary concerns all of us, and it is not exclusive, it is not only something, it's too important a question to be left just to people in the legal profession. So I think I appreciate, if there's a consensus in this panel, there's a consensus on transparency, definitely on public participation as much as possible and not being exclusive and being inclusive. I think one of the things that we would like to hear about is how do we make sure that that happens, because there are two powerful forces who are refusing to listen to anyone, both the judiciary and the judiciary.
Thank you. Is that a question for the panel?
No, so I just had a comment on the importance, because actually in the organizing of this particular meeting, the idea was to hear views but also think on how we can go forward, otherwise we did be just one other view. So can we try and think of a way and means by which we can actually be a voice that's heard? Is there a possible way?
Maybe there are people in the audience also who can answer that. There is a pen up there. So would the pen like to introduce herself? I think that is exactly the thought that is frightening both parties.
Yeah.
One second. The gentleman in the shirt at the back. The gentleman in the coat at the back. Could you introduce yourself as well?
Hi, my name is Rohan. I'm a student of law. My question is to Mr. Divan. So, you've had a large discussion on the transparency, but what about the complaint system? What thoughts on that? Right now, the only thing that we have in the form of a complaint system, the only instance that I know of, is a Madras High Court judge issuing notice to the Chief Justice of India. So how do we, build a complaint system regarding appointments, regarding transfers, which is workable amongst judges themselves, and those who want to be appointed but cannot or are not selected?
Thank you. Shall we take two more questions, panel, and then two more questions?
So, I'm K. Mahesh, I'm a civil servant, I'm Special Secretary of Home in Delhi Government. We talked about the litigation explosion with its 3.3 crore. Do you think that's a very big number when we are not leading a constitutional way of life? It's a very small number if you look at the human rights violation. Second, sir, can you talk about having lawyers of integrity, knowledge, without reforming the legal education, plus without reforming the Bar Council of India rules, the disciplinary authority under the Bar Council, the manner in which the elections are held on the basis of caste and corruption, what do we expect from such lawyers who are our potential judges? Third point, ma'am, since we have involved all the stakeholders in this conference, I think the administrative reforms, the civil services reforms, they are very important, as important, perhaps more important than the judicial reform, because the government is the biggest litigant. The manner in which the orders are being issued, passed by the civil servants, by the administrative authority. So if you reform the civil service, you can certainly, that will have an impact on the number of cases which are so high. Thank you.
In America,
sir, your name please and short call.
Yeah. In America, most brilliant students go to law college, but in India, it is just reverse. That means students who fail in high school are BA. They are not admitted in engineering and medical colleges. They are admitted in law colleges. Or they become politicians. And that is why our politics and judiciary are in conflict, because these failed students eventually become judges, and judges' knowledge is limited to the arguments of two sides. They judges never go to the field to acquire knowledge of the case themselves. So judgments are usually wrong, and they have also their relatives as liars or judges themselves. So that is why they are very secretive. They want to have a club of collegium so that their decisions are not known to other people.
Thank you, sir. As a lawyer and a person who failed in many things in her life, I tend to agree with you. Also, perhaps it is a judgment to all the people who are sitting here who are probably all going to law college only because they could not get into engineering. You are really bad cook. Sir, would you like to answer the question on RTI and the complaint system?
I think the last speaker said that most judgments are wrong. So if you want to remedy it, reverse the judgment. And they will all be right. So that's a very simple solution, which is my answer to my friend here,
yeah,
who spoke last. As far as Mahesh is concerned, Mr. Mahesh is concerned, he wanted administrative reforms. But today's discussion, we are confined basically to judicial appointments as well as the memorandum of procedure. So I think let's not go into a field much farther than judicial reforms or memorandum of procedure and the controversy on this. The first gentleman who asked me some question about how do you go forward and reconcile various differences of opinion amongst the judges themselves in the collegium or otherwise. Now, normally, how does a committee function? Or how does a collegium function? You try to go into the merits of an appointment and then decide one way or the other. If there is no unanimity, then you pass over the candidate. So I think that's a matter for the judges or the appointing authority to go into, basically. as far as transparency is concerned, I think what Manoj said and what Nirupal Basu said about RTI and the whole matter being in the public domain will act as a very big check on arbitrary appointments. And I think that may be the way to go forward. RTI should be available for judicial appointments. Unfortunately, as Manoj mentioned, the matter is pending in the Supreme Court. And until the Constitution Bench decides, I don't think we can move forward in any direction as far as RTI is concerned.
Thank you. And the complaints matter?
Complaints about?
He asked about how do you deal with complaints.
Accountability
of judges.
Look, as far as complaints are concerned, what the Supreme Court has directed is complaints not against functioning of the judges. Complaints against the potential candidates who are under consideration. This memorandum of procedure has nothing to do with auditing or the performance of actual judges who have been appointed. The complaint mechanism is only for the purpose of receiving complaints against potential candidates.
I have just one sentence about this Nikhil's question. I think that the question itself provides the answer. These are two powerful entities. I think lesser mortal men and women cannot influence that. But I think there should be a public opinion or public pressure built on these two institutions to somehow make up and find some ways and means to come up with an answer, because it is really delaying the process of justice delivery, and as we know, that justice delayed is justice denied.
One more brief comment from the right wing here on Nikhil Bey's question. I would, or comment, I would suggest, Nikhil, that we are actually in a bankrupt situation. We really don't have any good ideas, either the collegium system or NJAC. Perhaps NCPRI could set up a people's commission with, a mixture of backgrounds and also socially representative, and come out with a sound idea on how to approach selection of judges, both in the higher judiciary and in the lower judiciary, and that would then inform public debate as an alternate view. I think that would be helpful, and you have the credibility and the background to take the lead on that.
Statistic I want to add on the issue of inclusiveness. It just occurred to me to mention, share with you, that from the state of Andhra Pradesh, or rather I should say from the High Court of Hyderabad, which now services both Telangana and Andhra Pradesh, there happen to be, as of now, three judges in the Supreme Court. Justice Chalameshwar, Justice Ramana, and also Justice Nageshwar Rao, though he was picked up from the bar recently. Now, all three happen to belong to one dominant caste called Kamas. And it's a very small community, very, very prosperous, and they've captured strategic positions in various fields, and they seem to have monopolized the judicial space. All three judges from Telangana and Andhra Pradesh, two states, happen to belong to one small caste. That says something about lack of inclusiveness or not enough attention being paid to diversity in the judiciary.
Then at the Rajasthan also, before retirement, Justice Singh, Justice Bhandari, Justice Loda, same community, same city, same relatives, all things. But nothing on the individual.
I'm sorry, I do have hands up, and I know that as we go along, the discussion gets more animated, but my organizers will not allow me to chair again ever if I don't stop it now.
Yes.
So I must apologize. No, I will ask you to leave it.
It's relating to the
society. I'm sorry, there must be so many people who are wanting to relate, just like the Kambas are relating. So I think we better stop it over here. You've been hearing about appointments to the higher judiciary. In the next panel, you will hear about appointments to the lower judiciary. And these are even more, to my mind, well, there's no even more, but they are equally, if not more, important to the justice consumer, because that's where he comes to for justice in the first place. And there you have much, much more corruption and much, much more bias. And the whole, we're not talking even about the sanctity of fair trial. We now are accommodating ourselves to malfunction. And along the array of justice, whether it's from the police to the prosecutor to legal aid to the jail authorities to the court clerk and to the magistrate, the burden of that malfunction falls on the victim and on the accused. So everybody is taking their problems outside of the court. And the matter is becoming so bad that my fear is that the denial of justice will lead to so much open conflict, not only between private individuals, but also between the state and, of course, between collectives and mutinies, as we are seeing with the police, etc., and the paramilitaries, which is not being much talked about. So that the environment of fear and threat, you're looking at it when you look at the crime statistics for women in this country, which came out yesterday in this city, is going to be so bad that we will be willing to accept any kind of process. And that is my fear, and that is also my worry, that is this a game that is being played, that you just delay, that the situation gets so bad that we're willing to accept just anything. So with that uplifting note, I will leave you to the next panel. Thank you.
I request you to all stick around, and I also request our panelists to stay because we'd like to hear them as well on the subsequent panel. So we start in exactly 2 minutes. I'll just introduce all the panelists and we'll begin in 2 minutes. If he's going to be able to join us. Eminent speakers on the topic of judicial appointments with regard to the higher judiciary. In this panel, we will also discuss appointments to the higher judiciary, but with a specific focus on the lower judiciary as well. I think a few issues were highlighted in the previous panel, which sort of need to be taken forward and discussed, because constitutionally, there is no difference, really speaking, between the high courts and the subordinate courts. It's just about a matter of one has appeal powers over the other, supervisory powers over the other. So to that extent, both play an important role in the constitutional scheme of India. Before I begin, I'd just like to mention that Mr. Prashant Bhushan, Mr. Jaram Ramesh, and Mr. D. Raja, and Mr. Colin Gonzalez couldn't make it because of health reasons. And they've sent messages that that they'll not be able to do so. Professor Upendra Bakshi has sent in his suggestions in writing because he's unable to make it due to the traffic and the Delhi rains that we've had today. We'll circulate it in due course if you have left email. Thank you. So let me very quickly introduce the members of this panel. With me we have, I'll begin with Mr. Sanjay Hegde, who is a senior advocate of the Supreme Court of India and has appeared in many important cases relating to judicial appointments. So without any further ado, I'll just ask him to give his opening comments for about 8 to 10 minutes on judicial appointments, specifically focusing on subordinate judiciary. Thank you, Alok.
Friends, you see, the one thing that Main taught us was that a progressive society moves from status to contract. To me, a lot of issues, as far as the judiciary was concerned, was clarified when a former law secretary talking informally, why don't you all realize that you are essentially a service industry? We have so far cocooned ourselves, and Mr. Nilokpal Basu rightly put it as insularity, an island of insularity, an island of virtue. Whereas if you look at it, our function in society, whether as lawyers or judges, is essentially to handle and resolve as much of human misery as possible. A man who can't get divorced, a landlord who can't get his tenant out, somebody suffering at the hands of the government. Essentially, what we do is a service function, and what has happened is that we all tend to look at the problem from top down. The moment you say a judge, the figure is that of the Chief Justice of India. And from the Chief Justice of India, the elevated lords of the Supreme Court to the even more elevated lords of certain high courts. And then do you actually come down to the judge who you are most likely to see? Now, here, my particular view is that the greatest threat to judicial independence at that stage comes from what I call a creeping bureaucratization of the entire service industry. Rightly, wrongly, our country has been ruled by the civil services, of whose forebears Jawaharlal Nehru said that they were neither Indian nor civil nor a service. And that has left us with a history of everybody trying to pass a particular exam, and that exam, the one question that you get right or wrong being a determinant of the next 30 years of your life and all that follows, and whether you have a particular status or not. So when we transferred that onto our judicial services, because ultimately what has been burnt into the system is that the only determinant of quality is how well you spend 3 hours struggling with an answer paper. And progressively thereon, even assuming that you succeed, you're selected and all that, you tend to more or less structure your thinking according to answering exam questions. But that's not what life is. That's not what judges are meant to be. Judges essentially have to be deliverers of solutions, not people who ponder endlessly over problems. And what also happens as a consequence of our judges pondering over problems, of thinking precisely upon the question, is that there is a clogging of the system, or a clogging of an already clogged system. So, therefore, I would think that the first quality that, if ever I happen to be dictator of India, I would look for in a judge is a problem solver. Somebody who can encapsulate what exactly the problem is and give a solution, right, wrong, indifferent, but finish off. Otherwise, you have the line of tariq pe tariq, which some people are very fond of on social media to in their legal avatars. So the question is, where do we get those judges? Those judges who are at the first interface of our administration with the normal man in his misery. There was a gentleman out here some time ago who said that, you know, that it's only people who don't get anywhere who get into law college, those who don't get into engineering who get into law college, and then those who don't make it in the profession who then go on to become judges. Well, in his era that was true. I come from that era. We went from place to place, and then we finally arrested in law college, and then in the courts. But that's not true anymore. And that's also a great source of worry to me, because I now have children. I've seen a lot of junior lawyers who have abandoned engineering or who have even completed from the IITs and then come into law. So right now, as a society, we have some of the brightest young minds getting into the profession. I'm proud of that. But while I'm proud of that, I'm also apprehensive that they are getting into a system which is overcrowded, overclocked, and quite frankly, has ceased to deliver and ceased to hope that it can deliver. And I'm sorry if I'm being a bit too candid, but sometimes it does appear to me that the true analogy to the clogged Indian system is the clogged public toilet that India deals with. You have hosts of miserable people waiting. There is no other facility. And because there is no other facility, you go there. And there is nobody who gives a thought to maintaining that system, improving it, increasing the availability, just nothing. Because we are, again, I'm sorry to say this, we are a society which is much more fond of its status than of the utility of the process or of maintaining the process. So today, the greatest service that the younger minds of India could do would be to encourage the expansion of what is essentially a service delivery mechanism. This is a service which is essential to our democracy. This is a service which is being resorted to by more and more citizens as we grow up into being a more literate and a more legally literate country. What was resolved informally through panchayats, through whatever rudimentary justice systems that were also there, now come into the mainstream. It is time to streamline processes. Now, the thing is that there is no real institutional thinking either at the level of the executive, because very frankly, no politician really wants to be law minister, except practicing lawyers if they happen to get elected. Any non-practicing lawyer who's gone into politics and then ends up as a law minister, he basically says, I've got a dry ministry. I've been fobbed off with a consolation prize. And the reform also can't come in from the existing system driven top down by judges who happen to be in a position of authority to do something for very brief periods in their life. A man is Chief Justice of a High Court for about a year or two. A man is Chief Justice of India. I don't think we'll ever have a 7-year Chief Justiceship like Justice Chandrachud. We have had the Chief Justices for barely 17 days, 22 days and things like that. After all, how much institutional thinking can that man do? And I've rarely seen any set of judges acting in complete collegiality over a sustained period of time to make an intervention. So when we come now to the actual process of appointment of, I won't say the lower judiciary, but judges of first instance. We have gone back to the bureaucratic system of just marks equals merit, and after you get past the written exam, then come all those little tweaks which ensure that the right kind of judges get appointed. The right kind often mean, like I did a judicial service exam in Delhi case where Siddharth out here helped me greatly, where you had a huge number of people appearing, but very few people passing. And of those few people passing, by some amazing coincidence, there were only people who had some access to justices, either as law clerks or as having been divinely born. That is not the kind of system that a young India can tolerate for any sustained period of time. So the point today is, let us at least build sustained pressure to see that all available posts today in the subordinate judiciary get filled. That kind of pressure on every high court and every chief minister would have to be developed by at each state level. You cannot forever say that the limited resources that we have, our clogged system, whatever it be, we will wait our day. I have several more things to say, but today I will not hog the day. I have left you certain thoughts which you can think about. I'm always open to suggestion, and I'll keep writing on that. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hegde. Just following up from the format of the previous thing, Aparna, maybe we could build up a bit on this bureaucratization, as Mr. Hegde was pointing out, where the exam is seen as the most important thing. What do you think that this, what are the implications of this kind of a thing, and how do you think we can overcome that? What do you think can be done? Before I forget, let me just introduce Aparna. She's an assistant professor at the National Law University of Delhi, and she has worked with the Law Commission and many other bodies of legal reform.
Thank you, Alok. One of those bodies was the National Judicial Academy, where I had the privilege of working with a lot of judges at all levels of the judicial hierarchy, and that's where I get some of the experience that I want to talk about today. Before I answer your question, I just had a couple of points to make, which then will help me in answering your question better. One is that when we talk about the judiciary in India and judicial reform, we tend to focus so much of our energy on the higher judiciary that we tend to forget that it's the subordinate judiciary that's really at the front line of the justice system, and that they're the primary organs of the judiciary. So after all, you have the Supreme Court in one location, you have high courts in 39 locations across the country, and you have a district court in every district. Just this month, 7 lakh new cases were instituted before the district judiciary. But alarmingly, of the millions of cases that are pending before the district judiciary, 10% are pending for more than 10 years. So if the right to fair trial, if the right to speedy justice, if the right to access to justice, if these rights have to have any meaning, our primary judicial system has to be well functioning. So from this perspective, the fact that about 22% of the positions in the district judiciary is vacant is nothing short of a constitutional crisis. But if we think of this as a constitutional crisis, then the Supreme Court and the High Court have enough powers to make sure the judicial appointments take place on time. So you have the Malik Mazhar Sultan case, where the Supreme Court has asked for time-bound filling of positions, and they have been monitoring compliance. Just recently, the Chief Justice's Conference in 2016 has set up cells for compliance with this time frame. So there's enough judicial and administrative power if only they're willing to exercise that power. But I think the important question, and that, again, I'm sorry for this long preamble to your question, but the important question, I think, is why isn't there more of a hue and cry about the lower judiciary, about questions of appointment? We never hear this issue of appointments to the lower judiciary. We're so taken up with NJAC and the appointment of these 31 judges in the High Court and the 1,000 judges in the Supreme, the 31 judges in the Supreme Court and the 1,000 judges in the High Courts, that we're not talking about the 20,000 judges in the subordinate judiciary. I think that is something to do with how we conceptualize the role of the local courts, how we treat them within the larger system. So just this nomenclature, subordinate courts, I mean, that's a constitutional nomenclature. But these are courts of competent jurisdiction. In their own spheres of jurisdiction, they're completely independent. To think of them as subordinate and the other courts as superior is already placing them in a hierarchy where they are located in that hierarchy in the process of appeal, but not in terms of their jurisdiction. But more importantly, this nomenclature also betrays a deep feudal culture within the judiciary, which I think is at the heart of the problem of the subordinate judiciary. This is a feudal culture where judges of the subordinate judiciary and the higher judiciary do not meet each other as colleagues, but as superiors and subordinates. So you often find judges of the district judiciary waiting upon judges of the High Court. In fact, they are expected to do so. So judges will often tell you, and particularly the principal district and sessions judge, the highest judicial officer in a district, will often have to, in a district, might have to go and stand at the border and wait for a High Court judge who's passing through the district, see them through the district, and leave them at the other border. They're judges who are given protocol duty. I mean, it's laughable in the 21st century that we're even talking of these terms in any context, but think about it in the context of the judiciary, that they're given protocol duty to wait upon High Court judges. Some of this is, of course, a throwback to the colonial era, most of the trial court judges were Indians, and most of the High Court judges were Europeans, and there was a class system between them. But a lot of this comes from the control that High Courts have over the process of appointment and over the process of posting transfers in 235, 233, 235 of the Constitution and 227, the power of superintendents. So that if a trial court judge is not within the networks of power, if the High Court judges are not happy with the person, and happiness does not necessarily mean only in the quality of the judgments that they deliver, but in this ancillary stuff as well, then the chances of career progression for that individual trial court judge is significantly diminished. There are many other concerns as well, but what happens as a result is that there's a general discourse within the legal community where we don't think of lower courts as performing a constitutional function, thinking of them as constitutional functionaries. And even in our policy making, we're treating lower courts as fora to be avoided. You know, either have plea bargaining or bypass the court system through expansive interpretations of Section 482, 226, 227, just bypass the lower courts, let's go to the High Court, let's go to the Supreme Court, let's create tribunals, let's create plea bargaining, let's have ADR, let's avoid the lower court rather than embrace them and empower them. Now, not only as a result of this attitude, as a result of this feudal culture, not only do we see very little will to change, but also if changes do happen, like, for example, the big change that we discuss about when we're talking about appointments to the lower judiciary is the creation of the All India Judicial Services. I'm not sure that just creating an All India Judicial Service is going to attract the best minds to the lower judiciary. If you look at the All India Judicial Service, there's an understanding that this will just get us the best talent, right? The idea that talented people will apply just like they apply to the civil services. And because they will apply, we will get a better quality judiciary. Really, the devil is in the details. How do we work that system? How do we structure that system? Right now, according to the Constitution, according to Article 312, the All India Judicial Service will apply only to district judges, the higher judicial service and above. I think that's problematic because you're already then excluding the, again, between the district judiciary itself, the lower level judiciary, the magistracy, from that process. You're expecting judges who are putting about 12, 13 years of work as lawyers to then write an All India exam, compete for those exams. And here is the point, and this gets me to the point about bureaucratization finally, which is this, that after that point in time, having spent 12 years, 13 years at the bar, having absorbed the culture of the bar, and we see that there's a problem with it, with the culture of the bar, to think that these judges will be any different from what we already have is a problematic proposition for me. How do we bring about a culture change? I mean, that's not going to happen once you're set in your ways. In that sense, getting in people who just graduated out of law school, giving them, taking them in, whatever be their quality, and I mean, standardized tests is not the best way to test them. For better or for worse, we don't have many more other objective systems of testing. I mean, as an academic, I would be very happy if there were, but I don't know if other objective systems, given the concerns of nepotism that there are, maybe an objective system is better, but there can be so much of learning and relearning and unlearning that can happen in the post-appointment process if there is enough time. So if you are getting in 23, 24-year-olds into the judicial system through whatever method, even through this test scoring method, get them in, spend a considerable amount of time, as we do with civil in our civil service, in training, including, for example, field postings to a police station, field posting to a prison. That, I think, would be incredibly relevant in changing that culture, in getting in committed people, teaching and reteaching ethics. I mean, we don't do a good job of teaching ethics in law schools, I must say. So that, I think, would be very, very important. And just on the point of diversity, you know, we discussed that for the higher judicial service. It's not just about getting in, you know, it's not just about numbers, filling in vacancies. It's also very important who we get in. I started looking at the gender and caste breakup of the lower judiciary, and that aggregate data is nowhere available. Now, we know that only about 10% of the high court judges are women, and there are 9 high courts that don't have a single woman judge. So I don't know what the rates for the lower judiciary are. They're definitely much higher, in part because it's an exam-based system. However, women judges often complain that they do not have access to those networks of powers required for promotions. They're not part of the old boys club. And so they feel inhibited in networking with high court judges, both because they're socialized that way and because they're likely to face a backlash from their colleagues and seen as forward if they do network. So they often complain that the higher up you go, you will see fewer women because they don't have that same access. That is the reason why I think the system that we have currently of pervasive control of the local high court is problematic. And I think the best thing that the All India Judicial Service will do is to slacken the control of the local high court. I mean, it should still be within the judiciary, but not at the individual high court level, so that judges don't, the judges of the primary judiciary don't have to kowtow to judges of the high court, and we can start begin to change that culture. Because if the judiciary internally is not equitable, it cannot be an agent for social revolution, however much you might want it to be. So I'll stop with that.
Thank you, Aparna. Thank you all very much. And let me introduce our third speaker for today. This is Mr. Paul Divakar, who is General Secretary of the Dalit Arthik Adhikar Andolan of the National Commission for Dalit Human Rights. National Campaign for Dalit Human Rights. Mr. Divakar has worked with organizations across India and he has done a lot of work on this field. So, Mr. Divakar, just taking off from what Aparna discussed quite in detail, this feudal mentality of our judiciary, the fact that there isn't enough diversity, how do you think that affects and how do you think we can come out of it? What ways do you see us reforming our judiciary to get the kind of representative judiciary that, you know, India needs?
Thank you very much. I think that's a real hook. Thank you, Aparna, for bringing that both the, on the one hand, the feudal element, on the other hand, lack of diversity, specifically from the gender perspective. Let me share for the few minutes that I have from the perspective of access to justice from the other side, and then I come to the whole issue of the lower judiciary. I belong to the community which is affected by both sides of the law. I think all of us know that a large proportion of those who are incarcerated or scheduled castes and scheduled tribes, form of illegal detention, under trials, who have served far beyond the term of the particular acts. Then of course extrajudicial, so there's a heavy amount of incarceration and issues on that side of the law. Not just because of the administrative executive like police, but also because of the judicial system itself. And then more and more after the Scheduled Caste, Scheduled Tribes Prevention of Atrocities Act and several other social legislation that has been brought, we are beginning to see a perspective from the right side of the law. And let me not go into the incarceration. I think there the issue is very well known. But just we had done a series of studies of discrimination in special courts, discrimination that advocates face. And right now before me, there is a complaint from one of the junior civil judges from Andhra Pradesh, Kadapa, who has repeatedly complained against a sitting High Court judge of Hyderabad. And his appeals to the Chief Justice in both the courts had failed. Now we are attempting a PAL and also approaching the parliamentarians for impeachment. It's sad that a junior civil judge, because he has followed the law, the sitting High Court judge has managed to put tremendous pressure, and even to the extent of having him beaten up, he himself booted him. These are allegations, these are given in writing, well documented. He has complained to the police, he has complained to the High Court, he even brought it to the Human Rights Commission, he brought it, and this happened just 2 years ago. Since then, even today, we are saying his life is under threat, just because he happens to be from the Mala caste, which is the scheduled caste from Andhra Pradesh. If it was any other caste, by now there would have been such a hue and cry. Now, why is it? So just to look at it, just look at the rate of convictions. I think most of you would know. Currently, NCRB data 13 and 14, both IPC and special legislations, stands at 23.9 for scheduled caste and 28.8. This is conviction rate for the scheduled tribes, where the crimes registered in IPC for the general crimes, which relate to non-Dalits or generally, it is 40.2%. So very clear, because of lack of ability of the judiciary and several of its actors, who are unable to dispense and make sure that the rule of law is prevailed. You see all the major atrocities today, after being convicted under lower courts, have consistently been overruled by, whether it's in Bihar, whether it's in Rajasthan, whether it's in Andhra, Karamchevu, several of these cases have been acquitted. So what is the, where? So definitely On the one hand, we see the interplay of the feudal. Much more than that, I think the problem lies, of course, in the general society, but it's reflected also in the judiciary, the feudal mentality. They just do not see these as crimes. Now, how do you explain? You can explain to the police, saying that, you know, these are many a times when we even approach, they say, why are you coming here to file a case against this? This is a normal act. You know, the abuse, the kind of beatings, you know, after all, he has beaten you with the chappal. After all, he has beaten you with the... These are all crimes which routinely we have been undergone. And only in 1984 and later the rules were made in 1995, of course the amendments were passed just 2 years ago. The real rights of the Dalits have been prevailed, but the judiciary as such, even today, does not see these as crimes. I think they should be seen as crimes against humanity. We have recently also documented a case where in 30 days, again in Andhra Pradesh, a district judge has acquitted 36 cases just because, you know, his ruling was this crime was committed not because the victim is from the scheduled caste woman, but out of lust, and therefore it doesn't fall under the Scheduled Caste Act. So definitely the mirroring of the feudal. How have, after the constitution has been brought in, and when we don't have mechanisms which can screen these strains, you take it to any laboratory, what is this, Lal Pats or something, they will do you a screen of a virus within just now, I think any virus can range from maybe about an hour to maximum culture takes about a day, 24 hours. Why isn't this virus, whether it's a gender violence, whether it is the routine acceptance of crimes that are committed against the scheduled caste, just because you can't still now treat them as human beings, why is it that huge, all these process of selection, recruitment, orientation, and the training that you give with huge institutions like National Judicial Academy have not managed to root out this virus of crimes against humanity through caste crimes? Even to talk about caste crimes, they feel that they are discriminating. Some of the judges themselves have said, I don't want to discriminate. I don't want to treat everybody as equal. Don't bring me these things which are specifically caste related. Since Mr. Mohan Gopal has become the director at the Judicial Academy, he has every session, every other session at least, he would ensure there is one person with some knowledge on the Scheduled Caste, Scheduled Tribe, Prevention of Atrocity Act to talk to the and take about 2 days sessions. And I was appalled at the reflection of the casteist mentality, which has been, I think, the only clause in our constitution which forbids prevention of, I mean, untouchability, which has been outlawed untouchability. Still, these forms are very much are there. So I feel, somewhere, and this is reflected, we just looked at the victims, witnesses in the special courts. Lack of time, I'm not going, but that there is a denial of information from the special prosecutors. Seating arrangements, there is discrimination. You find that in schools, you also find it in courts. Actions of the court staff, if a Dalit advocate comes, the response of the court staff is different. Actions of the private advocates, judges, the Dalit advocates who are representing have to go through a dominant caste advocate to enter the judge's chamber. A Dalit advocate cannot access the judge's chamber today in Rajasthan. The advocates, of course, are so fearful that they may not have, but we have recorded evidence of the discrimination that still exists. The forced compromises, counter cases that take place, and the discrimination faced by advocates between the senior or not, even among the seniors or even among the Dalit advocates and the dominant caste, and the court clerks, their behavior, the public prosecutors do not support private advocates of Dalits to come and represent their clients. So I think acts or the whole constitution, which should have brought from the teeth of the Manusmriti and transformed the society into a basic human society for at least 25%, at least around 260 or maybe even more million people in this country, we cannot enter the portals of justice, because the judicial system still today has not found a way to address this virus of this heinous crime which is still being perpetuated. So I think definitely the starting point would be the lower judiciary and the magistrates. I think definitely in the area of diversity, ability to look at positively from the perspective of gender, from the perspective of caste equality, how is it that you are able to have a lens through which you are able to see, have a rule of law and interpret the rule of law in its fairness, and therefore diversity, transparency and social justice, if these can be put at the time of recruiting itself, at the time of orientation, at the time, I mean, many of the even advocates, many of the judicial, I mean, even at the magisterial level, are not aware of the social legislation. When they are the first ones, you take bonded labor, you take child labor, you take SCST prevention of atrocities, and of course, with all the sexual assault cases, it's appalling. So I feel one case, definitely we are very much concerned with the judicial accountability and this whole tussle that is going on. It really doesn't matter even a single strand for the Dalits, Adivasis and women, whichever way it goes. If you are not able to bring issues of diversity, issues of sensitization from this perspective, and make sure it is continuously part of not only your curriculum, but also several layers of recruitment that take place. You should ban such people who continue to have judgments which we are ashamed of even today. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Divakar. Since we are slightly short on time, I think we'll open it up for question and answers. I'll take three questions and then I'll have the panelists answer. So, that lady there, next to her. Please just introduce yourself very quickly.
Hi, my name is Arushi and I have two very short questions. So, the first is it time to start thinking about affirmative action when it comes to representation in the judiciary? And if yes, then what are the kinds of affirmative action we can expect? My second question is, so I think there are many compelling arguments in favor of diversity among them, the fact that it's now 2016. But should we be more circumspect before arguing that a more diverse bench will automatically lead to diversity in decision making? So I'm thinking specifically about some research I've come across in context of violence against women, where we cannot automatically assume that women judges will be more immune to blanket acceptance and very sexist forms of decision making actually.
Thank you. One second. This gentleman here.
My question is to Mr. Sanjay Hegde. I actually want to know your view regarding the proceedings against the judge, whether they should be initiated during his tenure, if there are any allegations, and if so, because only on the ground we live in a world where a person seeks for justice and approaches the court. So he has faith in it, and if there's any allegation, and the case is tried during the procedure, and in the tender of the particular justice, will it be justice so served? And for that matter, will he have the faith in the particular judge? And my second question is, whether the judges should be allowed to practice once they're retired.
Okay, thank you. This lady.
My question is to Aparna, and it's a couple of series of questions, but I'll try to try and shorten it. It's regarding AIJS. Considering the fate that NJC has had, and still staying optimistic, and if we figure out how to, get over the struggle over control between the high courts and the executive, also additional layer of center versus state when it happens, if we are to work on AIJS and figure something out about it. AIJS, as recommended by the 116th Law Commission, it says also for the creation of another body, say National Judicial Service Commission. Do you think that it will also end up having, or is it at risk of having a similar fate that NJAC met with? One more question. Yes, very quickly. Do you see any issue in the 45th Amendment to Article 312 vis-a-vis Article 233, 34, 35, where they have now been sort of given the special status, saying there is a special scheme, whereas 311, 312, all of these remain general scheme under the Constitution? So do you see any kind of issue?
Thank you. Mr. Divakar, I think the point about affirmative action, do you think that there's time for affirmative action in the court, and do you think it will necessarily lead to more social justice-oriented judgments?
Of course, it's a million-dollar question, but affirmative action, I think, is not an option, it's a starting point. If you have everything else and don't have diversity with some form of affirmative action, I mean, either you must think that all being born in one caste has actually accumulated so much of knowledge that everybody else is wiped out, or being born in one, I mean, just look at the India's performance in gold medals. I think there is a casteism there, mainly because the people who are able to win, you are not able to get. I think even in judicial, there is a thing. I mean, definitely, it's a starting point. You will need to have what form and what orientation, what are the skills they must have, and how do you screen sexist and casteist people from among the Dalit and women? Definitely has to be part of the affirmative action. I don't think without that, you can't, just because having the essentiality of one particular body is really, embodiment is not an answer. That's a very thing. But therefore, I think it is not just affirmative action. It's a curricula. It's a orientation. It's a kind of a priority that you give to these cases. It's a kind of direction that you give to the rest of the criminal justice administration. I think without that, you just only lean to affirmative action. I think it will be a failure.
Thank you, Mr. Robert. Mr. Sanjay Hegde has to leave, so I'm just asking to answer the question that was addressed to me.
Well, basically, you asked two questions. One was about complaints against a judge being tried during his tenure in office. See, the point is that protection of a trial and the entire procedure is only insofar as High Court and Supreme Court judges are concerned, as far as impeachment is. Obviously, if there is an impeachment motion and the judge wants to stick on, it has to be tried. There is no other way out. But the second question that you asked was about practice after retirement. Now, the fact of the matter is that there are certain drawbacks to judges practicing, but you must also take into account the fact that people live much longer these days. A man is productive, and especially in law, at ages 62 or at 60 if he is retiring from the subordinate judiciary. As long as he does not practice in a field which he once ruled, I don't see that as too much of a problem. That is still manageable. These are my preliminary thoughts, or I think beyond that, it is unsafe to regulate. Thank you.
Another question.
Can I also answer the diversity question? You know, no one is saying that diversity is the only thing that is needed. But having said that, in the system that we have currently, a more diverse system is always going to be better. If we anyway going to have casteist sexist judges, then why not have a diverse set of casteist sexist judges? I mean, it's a diversity is a good in itself. This is a public, so this is public employment. So having that resource shared amongst the entire community is important in itself. But I think we have to realize that we can't put an additional burden on women or on Dalits to be, you know, very different from others. That itself is being unfair. They also socialized as part of the same society. But what they do is they bring their own life circumstances and their own life experiences. So their own worldview is shaped by that. And that is why diversity, there is a hope that diversity will translate into different sorts of judgments. But of course, that's not going to be enough. Training is important, but I actually wanted to get back to the issue of the questions. And has anyone had a chance to look at the subordinate judiciary question papers across the state? It's objective type. So a typical question might be Article 21 protects A, right to life and personal liberty, B, right to equality, C, right to free speech and expression, and take the correct one. And what are we really testing there? There are different ways to devise your examination system, whatever your evaluation system is, that actually takes into account some of these subjective elements that we want judges to have. So more application-based questions. I mean, these are, you know, routine matters which can help. These are not grand things, right? But they can help in creating, in at least in appointing a cadre of judges who are coming to their tasks, at least, with a social justice orientation. And then, of course, the what you do with them and the kind of training that they provided thereafter becomes very important. On the question of the National Judicial Service Commission, that as the 116th report, Law Commission report, asked for, I don't think the same kind of issues as you've seen with NJSC will really arise, because at the heart of it is an exam-based system. So if you actually look at what the 116th report is talking about, they're still talking about 50% of recruitment from the, you know, from 50% of appointments through promotion, another 25% of competitive exam with, you know, just open to the lower judiciary, and then just 25% of the entire set as direct recruitment. And that's the 25% that they're seeking to capture. I mean, I don't think that's a good idea in any case, but having said that, because it's an exam-based system, I don't think the same issues will arise. The different sorts of issues that will arise is more with the center-state issue and the high court's fear of losing control, which has been the big stumbling block to why we don't have the National Judicial Service Commission. On the 45th Amendment, I don't know whether I got your question correctly, but already the 312 says that any a parliament can by law bring in the national, the All India Judicial Service, and that law will override the scheme in part 6, chapter 6. It will not be treated as an amendment to the constitution. So all that is required now is for the Rajya Sabha to pass a resolution and for parliament to bring in a law. So that question of conflict is not really going to arise if there is political will, and that's a big if.
We have time for one last question. I think this gentleman had a question. Just one last question.
Thank you. My question, in fact, I wanted to house the organization, but I missed it, in fact. This is relating to the, although there has been a lot of talk on it, that relating to the social equilibrium on the judicial administration.
Social?
Equilibrium.
Right.
On the judicial administration system, right from the ground level to the apex court. Do we have any data on that relating to their caste orientation or their asset orientation? Because that's very important. Being a lawyer, I have heard something very important, but I just wanted to talk from the panel.
You already shared it, but I was also preparing for this.
Yeah.
I just could not find any data on the caste, especially of the lower judiciary. I'm sure it's higher. because in the higher judiciary there is none, and it's easily known in the higher judiciary. But I think it will be good because the kind of things that Manoj was talking about, there is an over capture of one minority caste, but with a major kind of thing. And I think we need to address some of this.
With gender again, I couldn't find it for the lower judiciary. For the high courts, as I mentioned, 10% of high court judges are women, and the nine high courts that don't have a single woman. The Supreme Court right now has one woman. On caste, because there's affirmative action in the lower judiciary, because we already have it, at least in the initial appointments and in the promotions within the lower judiciary, we have a better caste composition than we have in the higher judiciary where there is no affirmative action. You have an interesting point of study, and I haven't seen data on it. I looked for it about 4 years ago, so I don't know if there's more data on it available since then. An interesting statistic would be promotions between the lower judiciary and the higher judiciary, because there is no need for them keeping caste considerations in mind, the caste diversity in mind, in promotions to the higher judiciary. It would be interesting to see of the 25%, or sorry, a third of the high court is made up of promotions from the lower judiciary. It would be very interesting to see what is the caste composition of that section, to see whether there is a glass ceiling at the district court level, even though there is affirmative action at the lower court judiciary. But as of 4 years ago, I can tell you that data wasn't available. I don't know.
Post independence here, I can give you a lot of interesting information on that.
Okay. Thank you so much, and I'd like to thank our speakers on screen, Mr. Sanjay Hegde, Ms. Aparna Chandra, and Mr. Paul Divakar. It was a very enlightening discussion, and a lot of aspects were discussed. Thank you all for attending this panel discussion on the appointments of the lower and higher judiciary. Do stay in touch. We will be conducting more such events, and we hope to see you all again. Thank you and good night.